classification of idiopathic interstitial pneumonia. Now, next step. Okay, I'll just write, you know, one more thing that is important, that when you are going to, now we are entering into radiology, okay, and we'll discuss one by one each and every pattern, okay, and the first pattern we're going to discuss is about the UIP, okay, but more importantly that you need to know is about, you know, what is expected from a radiologist, okay, and how do we proceed with the scan. So some scan related to scan that you should have when you know are going to you know scan somebody who is suspected case of an ILD. Okay, so one thing is that you should use your thin CT, thin section CT, okay, you know, less than or equal to 1.5 mm, it should be used thin section CT, okay. And the scans that you should, you know, typical inspiratory scan you should always have, obviously. Other than this, you should also have a post-expiratory scan, and you should also have a prone scan. Okay, inspiratory scan is a routine scan that we take. Okay, now what is the use of post-expiratory scan? If you have watched previous videos, you know, okay, that we want to look for the air trapping. Okay, we want to look for the air trapping. That is the reason. Okay, now why do we you know need a prone scan? Okay, why do we need a prone scan? So we need a prone scan because when the patient is supine, so the dependent part, let's say patient is supine like this, supine like this, okay, and this patient is supine, so the dependent part of the lungs, dependent part, okay, let's say these are the lungs of the patient, so the dependent part, these are the, let's say, dependent part, I have made like this. So the dependent part of the lungs, they become what? They become atelectatic and they become collapsed. So there's an increase in density there. Okay. Now that increase in density, say for example, if you have a mild disease, example, you have, let's say you must be dealing with a mild disease. And I'll just show, you know, when we'll discuss UIP, we'll realize that, you know, typically lung bases and subpleural areas are involved in UIP. So that, you know, the part that is getting atelectating in a supine position are exactly the same areas, or the posterior part of the lungs, posterior part of the base of the lungs are the same areas that, you know, that is involved in IIPs also. So since same areas involved and become atelectating on supine scan, okay, so if you are want to pick disease at its early stage, you know, which might present with, you know, mild reticulations or mild GGOs in its early phase, you know, an atelectatic posterior part of the lung that is due to supine or due to positional cause might mimic the disease. So you want to just exactly know whether the disease is there or not. That's why you do for prone scan. So that, you know, when the patient becomes prone, then if it is due to positional, it will, you know, positional cause, then it will what, disappear. But if it is due to disease per se, it will remain stagnant there. It will remain like that only, and you'll be able to know that. Okay, so that is the utility of the prone scan. Basically pick early disease. Okay, that is why prone scan, you know, so to pick mild disease. And it is very important to pick mild disease, you know, especially UIP. Okay, why it is important, I'll just tell. Okay, so these are the, you know, typical things, you know, that we need to proceed with when you have suspected IIP. Now just straight away we move to, you know, UIP. Okay, and it is really, really important. This section is going to be really important. So we're going to discuss about UIP is your usual interstitial pneumonia. Okay, and I have told in the last video that this is the histopathological and radiological counterpart. So it is written like this, IPF. IPF is what? So let me write it here. Idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis. Idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis. This is the clinical syndrome. Clinical syndrome. That is associated with it, IPF. It is written like this, 2IP and IPF, clinical syndrome associated with it. Okay, so let's say a patient comes to you, okay, and the patient says that I have a long standing, so this means a chronic, progressive, okay, chronic, progressive, exertional dyspnea, or basically, you know, breathlessness. Patient also have cough, which is typically dry. Okay, this is the history that the patient gives, okay, and you modified into your own medical terms. On physical examination, you have bibasilar inspiratory crackles. This is a physical examination findings on auscultation. Okay, and if I'm not wrong, these suggest basically fibrosis, inspiratory crackles. Okay, and so, you know, and patient also has inspection, you saw the patient's fingers, they're clubbed. So clubbing is also there. That is another thing that you have, digital clubbing. Okay. Okay. Now, if you have this particular syndrome, the patient with these clinical, clinical findings, whether history or, you know, the history of progressive exertional dyspnea or cough, and typically in an old patient, I should write one more thing, that is the patient is old. Okay. By old, I mean more than 50 years. Okay. So this patient with this particular things, okay, in question, this patient will be suspected. Okay. Somewhere it is more than 60 also. Okay. In some literature, it is more than 60 also. Okay. It's better to go with more than 60 because it's in the latest articles. Okay. So this patient is suspected, clinically suspected for IPF. So the patient will come to clinician, and with this history, the patient is clinically suspected for IPF. Only when the patient will be suspected for clinically IPF, only when clinically patient has no evidence of other causes. No evidence of other causes. Okay, there might be clinically or physical examination. On physical examination, if you have ruled out other causes, say for example, okay. So there is no evidence of other causes, and this patient is suspected case of IPF, okay, idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis, okay, on the basis of clinical syndrome. Okay, another important thing that you need to understand, that even if patient is more 42, 50 or 60 years, this patient can still be a suspected case of IPF if this patient has family history, because in the cases with the family histories, these cases typically, if there's a, you know, family history is there, that, you know, IPF runs in the family, okay, in generation to generation, in that case you should suspect it in at an early age, little a decade less, okay, so typically in, you know, middle age adults. Okay, so a patient of suspected case of IPF with these findings, but other causes have been ruled out clinically or this, okay, now this patient will be followed up with two things, and you have, you know, definitely you will have, you know, on physical examination you have investigation also that will suggest a restrictive pattern, okay, which I have told, reduce DLCO, reduce FVC, and FE1 by FVC, this ratio gets increased. Okay, so now once we know this thing, okay, so that is a clinical suspected case of IPF. Now we followed this patient with first thing that, you know, we commonly follow is typical chest X-ray. Okay, you cannot undermine this. Okay, although it is very less sensitive, and there will be cases in ILD where 15% cases will be normal on chest X-ray. 15% cases of ILD, there will be normal on chest X-ray. So sensitivity is quite low, and also You know, chest X-ray is just a preliminary investigation only. Okay, if you want to know the role, preliminary investigation only. It will just give you, you know, idea. Okay, that there is a reticulonodal pattern or reticular pattern. This is a distribution. Okay, so but ultimately you will need HRCT. Okay, so sensitivity is low. You cannot follow up a patient. Okay, on chest X-ray. Also, you will not be able to know exactly what type of ILD. Only everything will be in your will be blurred. Okay, so only on HRCT will follow up. Okay, on only on HRCT you will ultimately be able to diagnose the pattern. Okay, the severity and all those major things. So you'll need an HRCT. Okay, so if you did HRCT for this patient, and what exactly we see on HRCT in UIP is what we are going to discuss. Okay, and let's say if I do biopsy in this patient who is a suspected case of IPF, okay, what are the biopsy findings? So that is also important. But do we do biopsy in every patient? That is also a question. Can we do let's say if I suspect IPF, okay, so what is the first thing that I'll do? Obviously I'll go for imaging, biopsy being a non, you know, invasive thing. So I'll go for an imaging. So I did the chest X-ray. Okay, and after chest X-ray I'll go for an HRCT. If chest X-ray, no, even if chest X-ray is a normal, well, I'll go with the HRCT, because I just told at 15% cases they will be your definitely normal. Okay, and on, you know, HRCT on chest X-ray, so let's first discuss chest X-ray. Okay, let's first discuss chest X-ray. So on chest X-ray, what you are gonna see on chest X-ray? Okay, so firstly I'll need to give a concept for this. Okay, now what exactly UIP is? UIP is nothing but, now we know that it's an interstitial disease. Okay, so if I tell UIP, UIP is nothing but what? It's a fibrotic disease with lung. And the fibrosis that it occurs at a progressive rate. It's progressive. Now the rate of progression might be slow in some patients, but commonly it is large. And if I talk about the prognosis of the disease is quite poor. It's having a poor prognosis. Okay. The moment you diagnose patient with UIP, you are going to say that this patient is going to die in around 2 to 4 years from the time of the diagnosis. Okay, death at 2 to 4 years from diagnosis. And I am writing this statistically, mostly patient dies 2 to 4 years. Obviously there are patients, you know, there are variations, you know, in which the patients live longer or they have a slow progression, but it has a poor prognosis. That is the stigma that is associated when you say that this is a UIP. Okay, that is why when you say UIP, you want to, you know this with the confidence, because there is a association with the prognosis, and that is why you need to diagnose it early. Also, if you diagnose it early, what happens, we know one thing, that is if it is a fibrotic disease, it is irreversible also. So the fibrosis is irreversible. We know this very well. Since it is irreversible, it becomes important and instrumental to diagnose the disease in early stage. Because by diagnosing in early stage, because the diagnosis in early stage is important, why? We can start the treatment early stage. So that treatment can be started, because we have antifibrotic drugs, you know, which will slow down its course. Antifibrotic drugs, typically nintedanibs and all those danibs drugs we have. So that is why important. It is important to, you know, suspect UIP. Okay, diagnose it with surety. Whenever you need biopsy, you will go for biopsy as well. I'll tell you when do you need biopsy. When do you advise patient to be having biopsy after seeing the HRCT image? But typically it's a fibrotic disease, interstitial fibrotic disease. So we'll have interstitial fibrosis, and that interstitial fibrosis is progressive. Now, once we know this concept, okay, we have fibrosis. So interstitium getting fibrosed. Okay. And typically, what is the distribution? If I ask, the most important thing that we have is, what is the distribution? So we know that the fibrosis is going to happen, distribution. So the distribution of fibrosis is bases of lung, bilaterally, bases of lung are there, and subpleural areas. Subpleural areas. And you need to just know it by heart, you know, that it is subpleural areas and bases of the lung bilaterally that are affected by this fibrotic disease. It's a progressive fibrotic disease. So these are the areas that are going to be affected. Okay. Now, once you know that these areas are going to be affected and fibrosis is increasing day by day. Okay. So definitely interstitial fibrosis, what do you see? We know how, you know, interstitial fibrosis looks like. On chest x-ray or on HRCT, it will be giving a reticular pattern. It will be giving a reticular pattern. Because, you know, interstitium is getting thickened. Okay. Reticular pattern will be there. Both on chest x-ray as well as on HRCT. If you do not know the basics, go for the basics. But we have discussed it. Now, if fibrosis keeps on increasing, you know, so advanced fibrosis, when the patient goes in advanced fibrotic stage, you know, so these fibrotic opacities will cause destruction of alveoli, and ultimately a pattern, imaging pattern will appear in which, you know, the walls of alveoli are destructed, they unite or they collapse. Okay, so yes, there will be formation of multiple cysts, and those cysts will have thick wall because they are, the wall is fibrous, so it appears to be thick, and they have merging walls, so they have wall sharing between them, and there are multiple cysts, you know, lined in one line, or there are multiple lines, okay, multiple lines in subpleural area, and we call it what? We call it to be honeycombing. We call it to be honeycombing, which is your advanced fibrotic stage. Now, honeycombing, remember this thing. You don't know that how much stars that I want to put over this particular finding, because the moment I listen to honeycombing, I just remember only one thing, and that is your UIP. I'm not saying that it is only in UIP, but remember this thing, when you see honeycombing, you look for UIP. You want to rule out UIP in that patient, okay? Because fibrosis progresses to this stage only in certain diseases and advanced stages, okay? Commonly patient dies before that, or patient has a treatment. If the patient is progressing, because this disease is progressive, the prognosis is poor because the treatment is not that effective. Even if you give treatment, although it will halt the progress of that fibrosis, but ultimately fibrosis is going to happen, and patient might be coming to you late also. In that case, you might be seeing an advanced fibrotic stage. The patient will be having honeycombing. So honeycombing is an important thing, okay, that you see in advanced fibrotic stage. Now, honeycombing is a, again, it's a HRCT diagnosis. It's a HRCT pattern or HRCT finding. The counterpart of honeycombing, I have told and discussed in the basic, it is your medium type of medium type of reticular pattern. Medium reticular opacity. We discussed reticular opacities into fine reticular opacities, fine reticulations, medium reticulations, medium typically, you know, which have air spaces bordered to be 3 to 10 mm. Okay, you will just discuss in the basic videos only. So medium reticular opacities, this is the finding that correlates on chest x-ray. Okay, you know, this might be hidden here. This must be hidden here, so I should remove it and I should write it here. Okay, write it here. Okay, so yeah, so I'm writing it here only, okay, or in the next section. See, so we were discussing honeycombing, and honeycombing, I just told that it correlates with two things. It's a HRCT finding. On chest x-ray, it correlates with medium reticular opacities. where you have, you know, 3 to 10 mm are the spaces. Typical, I'll show them on Excel how does it look. So this is your honeycombing. So we discuss about the reticulation. Okay, we discuss about reticulations, we discuss about the pattern of distribution, and we discuss about the honeycombing. So these are the three things that should come into your mind. Okay, so I should label them also. So this is your, the distribution is the first most important thing. Second most important thing is your reticular pattern. Third most important point is your honeycombing. I wrote these things. Okay, distribution, reticular pattern, and honeycombing. Three things you should not forget. Now, we know that fibrosis is there. Fibrosis is gonna be what? Fibrosis is gonna be increasing. Fibrosis is gonna be increasing. And if fibrosis is gonna be increasing, what will happen? We know. Secondary to fibrosis, what happened? Traction bronchiectasis. Traction bronchiectasis happened, or bronchiolectasis due to tethering effect. This is going to happen. So it's a secondary finding. So you can label it to be 4. Okay, but it will always be there if the fibrosis is there. Okay, it will always be there. So these are the typical 4 findings, or you may call 3 findings. Okay, one is your, okay, I'll write it again because it is important to remember. Subpleural and base distribution. Second important thing is your reticulations. Third important thing is your honeycombing. And if you want, okay, traction bronchiectasis. Now this is a typical, if you have seen this particular, this is a typical UIP pattern. This is your typical UIP pattern. Okay, remember this thing. Now among this, if you ask me that, sir, tell me the most important thing among this to call it to be UIP, I would say it is honeycombing. Okay, it is your most important. Why it is most important, I'll tell you in a minute. Because if you do not see honeycombing, you start questioning from there that whether it is UIP or not. Okay, so it is so important for this to be called it. The moment you lose honeycombing out of the list of this particular 4 things, this word typically is gonna go. Okay, it is so important. So what makes a UIP pattern, typical UIP pattern, is your honeycombing. That is to be focused. So you look for honeycombing always. Whenever you have this kind of distribution or you have reticulations, these are very non-specific thing, okay? Reticulation is non-specific. This distribution is a little bit specific, obviously, because subpleural and base areas are involved. This distribution is very, very important also. Second to this honeycombing, I think the most important thing would be distribution only. And traction bronchiectasis is a secondary, so it's the least important among the 4, because, you know, I have already told also that traction bronchiectasis happens whenever you have fibrosis, and fibrosis will appear like, interstitial fibrosis will appear like a reticulation only. But the distribution and the honeycombing are the 2 most important thing, and the moment honeycombing goes, the typical word goes. Okay, and what all words come, will, you know, describe in detail. Okay, so that is about the you know, radiology. All these are the images or the findings of a typical UIP pattern. Okay, now another important point that we need to discuss is, see, on histopathology, little bit discussion of histopathology as well. On histopathology, the characteristic finding that you see is fibroblastic foci. Fibroblastic foci. That is the typical histopathological finding. Now, I'm not going into detail of histopath, but few things that I want to enlist, and that is one thing, this fibroblastic foci is the, you know, the hallmark of it. But the most important thing that you have in this typical UIP is you have a spatial and temporal heterogeneity. And you see this particular thing only in, because fibroblastic foci, okay, it's a hallmark, but it can be seen in other diseases as well. Okay, in fibrotic diseases, other fibrotic diseases, but spatial and temporal heterogeneity is typical of UIP. And what exactly it means? See, there is a heterogeneity, okay, and it is a spatial. Spatial means in form of in position, in space, and temporal is nothing but your time. Okay, this means that if you biopsy lung of a patient, okay. Remember this thing, when you are suspecting IPF, okay, you biopsy it at multiple areas. It's important to biopsy at multiple areas. Multiple biopsy is important. Okay, why it is important? It's because of this only. Why? Because you will be having multiple areas, okay, multiple areas, okay, because lung is not affected diffusely. Lung is affected at certain areas. So there will be normal areas interspersed between abnormal areas as well. So there is a position, okay, that there is a spatial heterogeneity, okay, and the time is there that that lesions will be at different stages. Okay, lesions will be at different stages. That in which, you know, let's say you have a lesion here and you have a lesion here. If you take biopsy from this, let's say this lesion is your end stage fibrotic lesion, and you take biopsy from this patient, this is an active lesion. Example, it's an active lesion. So at the same time, you have multi-stage lesions. Okay, that is why temporal heterogeneity is there, that the disease is progressing at different time, you know, at multiple areas. Okay, and also the disease is interspersed normal areas also. So histologically, you have spatial and temporal heterogeneity, that is very classical of, you know, histopathology in UIP. Okay. Okay. Now, that was about the histology, okay. And on histology, okay, one thing that I forgot to tell is that most common, if you want to know ILD pattern, most common ILD pattern, it is UIP only. Among all 8 that I wrote, it is counting for 40% cases. Okay, 40% cases. And you know, I that UIP can be associated with cause, I told also, and it can be unknown cause. And when you have unknown cause, you call it to be the clinical syndrome associated with it is your IPF. So IPF, how many percentage of cases, let's say if you have 100 cases of UIP, how many cases of IPF are, you know, accounts for 100, how many out of 100 cases, how many cases of IPF are there? Okay, so 70% cases are IPF. So it's also, if you want to know, the most common cause of UIP is basically idiopathic cause. Most commonly, the cause is not found, and that is why 70% cases are your IPF. Okay, so that is one thing. Okay, so that is about this. Now, so we discuss about this. Now, next thing that we're going to discuss would be, so first let's look at the x-ray first. Okay, we'll slowly go into details. Let's look at the x-ray. Okay, so this is the x-ray, and in this x-ray you can clearly see that there is a, you know, reticular pattern. Okay, we have a reticular pattern here, clearly visible reticular pattern. And if you see closely, that reticular pattern, you know, as you move from top to bottom, you see the reticular pattern is increasing. Okay, there is, you know, upper zones are also affected, but predominantly if you see that lower zones are more affected than upper zone. So I can say that, you know, that base is affected more than apex. So that is why there is a apico-basal gradient. Gradient is there. Okay. Now, another thing that I could see is reticular opacities are there. So once I see reticular opacities, if you clearly see the spaces, let's say this is a space, this is a space, these are spaces, you know, surrounded by the networking, these spaces are typically 3 to 10 mm in size. That way it is your medium level reticular opacities, medium type, which correlates on HRCT with honeycomb mean. So this distribution and on HRCT, okay. Now this distribution of reticular opacities, this particular distribution and these findings make me think of IPF or UIP pattern, but obviously I cannot write it on chest X-ray report, okay. So what I'll advise the patient, I will advise the patient to go for an HRCT thorax. That's how I'll be writing my findings, and I'll write a query UIP and I'll proceed with an HRCT thorax, okay. So we need to go for, you know, an HRCT, okay. So we'll just in a minute we'll look for the HRCT, okay. How does it look on HRCT, okay. Another thing that, you know, you might be knowing that when you look at the HRCT, the, you know, the more other things apart from lung parenchyma you need to see, okay. Other than lung parenchyma, you need to see other things as well, like airways, okay, and vessels. Why it is important? Because you might pick some findings on HRCT that are suggestive of a collagen vascular disease or other disease for that matter that might be a cause of you know, UIP that you just found. So how it looks on HRCT, let's go towards that, okay. Okay, so let's look at the image. So this is a coronal image, this is a coronal image, okay, of HRCT thorax, okay. We'll discuss so many cases about this UIP, but you know, as a preliminary thing, I'm going to discuss about this only, okay. So let's look at this again. One thing that you're going to see is, first of all, you see both lungs together, and whenever you want to look for the apico basal gradient or, you know, the distribution, you always look at the coronal thing because it gives you the whole idea of the lung picture, okay, that what part of the lung or what lobes of the lungs are affected. Better to look at the coronal image. So on the coronal image, you can clearly see that if you compare, that disease is more pronounced in your mid part or the lower part of the lung, okay. This part or this part is more affected than apex. So definitely there is an apico basal gradient, okay, that is for sure. Okay, first thing that we look at, that the disease is more common there. Now next thing, that where the disease is, if you really closely see it, you see closely the disease is in your subpleural areas. See, subpleural areas. Here also it is subpleural areas. See, this is subpleural areas. And obviously the lung is also, lung parenchyma is also involved in the center, but typically it is subpleural areas, okay. And base is affected more, base of the lungs are affected more than apex, or okay, typically more affected. And you see subpleural areas as well, okay. So the distribution, one thing is about the subpleural and the basal areas of the lung is affected, okay. Next thing that you are gonna see, next thing that you're gonna see is that once you know that, you know, what areas are affected, next thing that we're gonna see is what is the findings. What is the findings? So findings are, see, you see this small cyst, and these cysts are lined together in lines, okay. So this is what, this is your typical honeycombing here, this is your typical honeycombing. And okay, I'll just revise what are the criteria, what is the criteria of honeycombing. So for honeycombing, you should have cyst, multiple cyst, okay. They are typically in the rows, and what do you have? You have cyst sharing walls, cyst sharing walls. So they should share walls, okay. There should be multiple cyst. Typically you need to have at least 3 cysts in one row to diagnose honeycombing. The minimum criteria you have, you should have thick walls also, and the distribution should be subpleural distribution. So if you have these criteria fulfilled, you call it to be honeycombing. So these criteria are very well fulfilled. You can see they have thick wall, they are close to each other, they are opposed to each other, and they share the wall. Okay, they are subpleural in location and they are multiple here also. Okay, here also. So this is typical honeycombing that you are seeing in the subpleural areas. Okay, other than this, if you see this, these are fibrotic opacities, these are interstitial fibrosis that is there. And you have interstitial fibrosis interspersed here. So this is interstitial fibrosis. We have reticulations also. We have evidence of reticulations also. Okay, in association with this and this particular distribution. Now this is a typical HRCT pattern of UIP. Okay, that is shown in this image. Okay, typical. This will be labeled as typical UIP pattern. Because every possible thing, that four criteria, and if you see closely, that if you see this particular thing. See this thing, just I labeled. Okay, let's rub me. Okay, so see this thing, this is a bronchial and it is dilated. There is absence of tapering of this bronchial till the periphery, so it has almost reached the periphery. And you see surrounding opacities also, that is your, you know, reticulations are also there. So this is what, this is traction bronchiectasis. This is your traction bronchiectasis. Okay, fibrosis. Okay, this is ultra traction bronchus, and the bronchial are dilated, tubular bronchioles are dilated. But these are your cysts. These are your cysts. Okay, so this is your typical UIP pattern that you see on HRCT. Okay, typical HRCT pattern, UIP. Okay, now same findings, you know, here also I can see. See this, you know, this is the same patient with multiple sections, and you know, you have coronal section, axial sections, and this is a zoomed image. So here also, if you see that, you know, this is the base of the part, this is the basal part, you can see diaphragm coming up. Okay, and diaphragm is coming up. So this is the basis, and if you see, these are the apices, these are the apices, these are the bases. So you can clearly see the bases are getting involved. Okay, bases are getting involved in subpleural areas, again subpleural areas there, and posterior part, this is the posterior part. Okay, posterior part of the basal areas are involved, and apex are typically normal here, almost near normal. There are few, you know, subpleural fibrotic areas are there, but typically it is normal. And there is a, on coronal, when you do the coronal section, coronal reformation, you can clearly see base is involved more than apex. Okay, so you again, you have a picobasilar gradient, a picobasilar gradient you again have. Now since you have a picobasilar gradient here, okay, when I zoom this image, what do you look that in subpleural location, you can again see this is a classical honeycombing, beautiful honeycombing that is seen here. Multiple cysts, okay, with thick walls, sharing walls in subpleural location. So all criteria are fulfilled that it's your honeycombing. The moment you see honeycombing, you see this distribution. Okay, and you see, you know, there are areas, you know, what are these? These are what, interlobular septal thickenings. If you see, they are running perpendicular to the pleura. This is how the, you know, pleura, you know, typical reticular opacities due to interlobular septal thickening is also there due to fibrosis. And since you have honeycombings, it means that it's an advanced stage of fibrosis. And all those criteria that are fulfilled for it, calling it to be typical UIP pattern. Interlobular septal thickening also causes reticulations, we know that. Okay, and the periphery, it looks like this, only that you have fibrotic, thin fibrotic bands like opacities that run perpendicular to the pleural surface, which is your interlobular septal thickening. We commonly do not see it on normal HRCT, but when it gets thickened, we see. So all these findings, a picobasal gradient, okay, base getting more involved, subpleural location of honeycombing. Now this is a typical, the moment I see honeycombing and this distribution, it is a typical UIP pattern. No question about it. You do not need biopsy in this also. I'll discuss the guidelines also, but typically you don't even need biopsy after this. Once you see this on HRCT, you'll write a typical UIP pattern and the patient will be started on treatment without going for biopsy. Okay, but as you know, the world is not black or white, world is gray. Okay, world is gray. Why world is gray? Because obviously, if you see this particular pattern, the predictive value is obviously high. With this particular, more than 90% patients will be diagnosed on UIP on histopath as well. Okay, on histopath as well, 90% predictive positive predictive value is there. Okay, but obviously there'll be cases in which you will not see the same findings or this classical case as we are seeing here. Okay, we are not will not see classical case, and there is a challenge to diagnose UIP, and that is why literature is, you know, vast. There's a vast literature of, you know, there are vast guidelines, you know, that have evolved over time, okay, about diagnosing UIP. And the reason being, you know, so much research in this particular area is very clear. Why? Because UIP is a diagnosis of poor prognosis, and you want to diagnose it as early as possible so that you will start the drug, so that the quality of the life that is already remaining life is quite small. You know, you have, once you diagnose this patient with typical UIP pattern, is saying that you're going to die in 4 years. Mostly only 20-40% survival, 5-year survival rate is there. So once you label it to be UIP, you know, saying the patient, you know, you're giving a, you know, timeline for that patient for dying, because the fibrosis is going to increase, okay, and ultimately the patient is going to die. So that is why it is important to diagnose at an early stage, and that's why we need so many, you know, to revise guidelines so many times. But what are the current guidelines? I'll discuss. Okay, so we discussed about a typical UIP pattern. One thing that I didn't tell, and that is your that when you have, you know, you saw the chest x-ray, if I ask you, you know, that on chest x-ray, what is the, you know, this is your chest AP. It's an AP view. Okay. Obviously, we'll have PA view as well. Okay, but if you ask me, what is the most sensitive view of chest X-ray to look for IPF, UIP? Answer would be lateral view. Remember this thing, it will be lateral view. Why lateral view? Because fibrosis, what is the initial in early UIP, when the disease starts, the fibrosis, early UIP would be what? Now we know honeycombing is an advanced fibrotic stage. From the early stages of fibrosis, you have reticular opacities. So the reticulations in early UIP are typically at what? Posterior costophrenic angles. This is a typical location in early UIP, and since you have posterior costophrenic angle, obviously you are going to see those angles. Where you're going to see it? On lateral x-ray, lateral view. You're going to see it on lateral view. That is why the most sensitive view is your lateral view. It's not PA or AP. Okay, and what location we're going to look at? We're going to look at the what? Posterior. Now, as fibrosis will progress, we'll have other cases. Okay, we'll have other cases. Okay, so we discussed this. Now, definitely, you know, we'll be having these findings, you know, typically patchy or clustered areas. Okay. So if I ask you, you know, can upper lobes be involved in IPF or UIP? Obviously they can be involved, but definitely lower lobes are more involved than you upper lobes. So there's a pico basal gradient should always be there. Okay, they're less affected than base of the lungs. Okay, now another important point that is very mandatory or almost important to be discussed is that okay you saw honeycombing. Okay, let's discuss one more entity with it, so that the diagnosis will become useful. See, with the UIP, another thing that we describe, and in some patients of IPF, you know, some patients of IPF, they may be associated with one more thing, and that is your emphysema. Okay, they may be associated with emphysema. Why emphysema? Why? Because a patient might be a smoker, and you may be having coexistent smoking history as well. Because smoking is so common, patient might be, you know, smoker, and the patient might have emphysematous changes as well. Okay, smoking will cause all those changes, emphysematous changes, and patient will be having UIP pattern. But patient, no, it is always important to write UIP. IPF is a clinical finding. What we are discussing, either histopath or radiology. So if you have UIP and emphysema together, there is a syndrome okay, it's clinically it is what, or it is termed what radiologically, okay? So it is what? Combined pulmonary fibrosis and emphysema. So it is your nothing but your CPFE, in short, CPFE, combined pulmonary fibrosis and emphysema. Now it is commonly seen in smokers because you have emphysema there, okay? And this patient will have a very poor prognosis. This patient is gonna be, you know, high chance of mortality are there. Even more severe than the, you know, UIP alone. And since you know that emphysema is there, what type of emphysema will be typically seen here? So it is your paraseptal emphysema. And, you know, typically if you see paraseptal emphysema, there's always a component of centrilobular emphysema also. How these centrilobular paraseptal looks, obviously we'll discuss later in this one video on COPD. But paraseptal means in perilymphatic distributions, so around the pleura, subpleural areas or perifacial areas is what paracentral, and centrilobular, we know what is centrilobular, at the center of the lobules. So emphysematous changes are there, and these emphysematous changes characteristically are in what location? They are in your upper lobes. These are in your upper lobes. Okay, so we have upper lobes here, emphysema in upper lobes, and UIP in CPFE is seen, always UIP is seen in what? Lower lobes. Okay, so you have UIP lower lobe and upper lobe emphysema, that is what is seen in CPFE. Okay, and there's a high chance of mortality in these patients are likely to develop. See, ILD always is a risk factor for what? Any ILD is a risk factor for, remember this thing, for carcinoma lung. It's a risk factor. And ILD will eventually, as a part of complication, can lead to pulmonary hypertension, which can progress to right heart failure. Okay, right heart failure. So carcinoma lung, okay, pulmonary hypertension. As a complication, it can proceed to that level. Similarly, but when you have CPFE with you, then obviously the chances of progression to these diseases or the complications is quite high. And that is why patient with smoking, you know, they have CPFE. So they have upper lobe this. How does it look? That is also important. And there where another concept comes, that, you know, see, what is emphysema? First of all, I have not discussed till now in a video, but we'll be discussing this in a separate video. Emphysematous changes, how do their appearances on HRCT? We'll have a separate video on that. Don't worry about that. But on emphysema, how does it look? So it's basically what? Enlarged air spaces. And these are irreversibly enlarged. Okay. Air spaces, alveolar walls get broken down and they're irreversibly enlarged. Okay. And so we have irreversibly enlarged air spaces. And but typically, when we have discussed this also, okay, in your basics video, that emphysematous changes, the wall is present or not. So walls, so there'll be, it will appear like cyst only, cyst-like. That is why it is classified under pseudocavities. Because it's a cyst secondary to some cause. It's not a primary cystic disease. So these are pseudocavities. These cysts are pseudocavities due to emphysema. Now walls of, do you see walls here in emphysematous changes? We do not have wall typically, or you may have thin wall. That is what we discussed, that you do not see wall here. Okay, that is an important point. And do you think that this enlarged, irreversibly enlarged air space is due to fibrosis? Is it due to fibrosis? The answer is clear cut, no. This is not due to fibrosis, this is due to smoking. Okay. So these changes are not due to fibrosis. Obviously, fibrosis can lead to emphysematous changes. Okay, typically irregular type of emphysematous changes. But here, it is not due to fibrosis. Okay, that is one thing that you need to know. Irregular type of emphysematous changes can be seen with your fibrosis. But here, you are seeing paraseptal emphysema with small component of centrilobular emphysema. And It is not due to fibrosis, it is due to smoking effects. Okay. Okay. So that's what we see here. So since fibrosis is not there, so let, and typically upper lobes are involved where, you know, the contribution of fibrosis that is going on in the patient of IPF would be less. So in upper lobes, you will see cyst in paraseptal distribution. In subpleural areas, there will be cyst. And these cysts are typically lined, you know, in one line. They will be variable in size, but they will be having no walls and there will not be any fibrosis associated with them. So there will not be any architectural distortion associated with them. And why I'm telling you this, that when you see a case of CPFE or when you see coexistent emphysema as well as IPF, it will become difficult for you to differentiate between on radiology, honeycombing versus paraseptal emphysema. Honeycombing versus paraseptal emphysema. So the points are favor, like honeycombing. Okay, one thing, the one important point that will is the distribution. Okay, so bases here, it will be upper lobes. Anyway, another important point, wall here, the wall are thick here, the wall are thin or absent. Another thing, associated fibrosis or reticulations basically, or your architectural distortion. So it is present here, it is absent here. Okay, and one more thing is that if you see multiple lines or multiple layers, if you see, so layers are multiple here. You can have obviously single layer of honeycombing as well, but typically multiple, it is single. Okay, so these are the areas that, you know, on which you will be able to differentiate honeycombing from paraseptal emphysema. Now look at the look at the image of this. See this image, and now look very closely. See, let me zoom this image first. I think it's fine. So in this image, you can clearly see, look at the base. This is a coronal CT image, obviously in lung window. So you can see that, you know, you see the bases and you see the subpleural location here. See this, let's look at this point. Okay, you can see this bases. So you can see there are reticular areas there. And if you see this, this is your typical traction bronchiectasis. If you see traction bronchiectasis, you can see fibroticopaestes. This is a fibroticopaestes that is, you know, I just marked red. And you see fibrosis here. See fibrosis here. This is fibrosis. These opaestes are fibroticopaestes. Okay. And you see the traction. See this bronchiole going, you know, till the last to the periphery. And, you know, see there is an absence of tapering. So this is your nothing but your traction bronchiectasis. This is your traction bronchiectasis. Okay. That is there. Okay, and you see honeycombing also here. The small honeycombing, it's not very that much prominent as we saw in the last image, but it's there. So trust me on that. It is there. Okay. But what you're seeing in upper lobes? See in upper lobes, this cystic areas, circumscribed areas of lucencies. If you see closely here, you see fibrotic changes are there in the basal part of lung, but you do not see fibrotic changes in upper part of the lung. There are no adjacent fibrotic changes. And if you see, look at the wall. So you do not see wall here, absent or thin wall is there, and they are typically in layers, okay, and in paraseptal distribution. So this is what is your emphysema. Emphysema test changes are there, and what you are seeing actually is a case of CPFE. It's a case of CPFE, combined pulmonary fibrosis and emphysema. Okay, this is a case of CPFE, and this patient has a. So it is characterized under UIP only. When you have UIP coexistent emphysema as well as features of UIP, so we see fibrotic changes, traction bronchiectasis, reticulations in the base of the lung, and you see emphysematous changes in the upper part of the lung. and that is what is your CPFE is. Okay, that is what is your CPFE is. That was about CPFE. So we discussed one more entity with this. Okay. At times you may be confused between traction bronchiectasis also, and you know, like honeycombing can be confused with emphysematous changes. Similarly, honeycombing can also be confused with what? Traction bronchiectasis. Okay, but that is very easy. Why? Because if it's a bronchiectasis, you will see continuity with those cystic areas with airway. Then you can easily diagnose, because honeycombing is like what? It's a cyst. It's a discrete cyst. So the discrete nature will differentiate. This is easy to differentiate. Okay, when you scroll the image, you will be able to see, okay, that it's continuous anyway. But it can, you know, look like same thing, you know, when you look at a snapshot or something, look like the same. Okay, so you see this. Now